Hello, everyone. I'm Kate Baldwin, and happening right now, a critical test of Republican unity and a critical moment for a president and a Congress who say 2018 is now on the line and a critical first step to the tax overhaul that Republicans have long promised. The House is voting right now to pass a budget plan, but maybe more importantly here, that vote allows for a fast track for any tax reform bill that they would put together down the road. And for Republicans already worried about next year's midterms, a failure here could be fatal. If President Trump is worried, he is not showing it. Minutes ago, he tweeted, "Do not underestimate the unity within the Republican Party." That's quite some statement after the week that we've had already. CNN's Sunlyn Sarfati is on Capitol Hill with more. Sunlyn, where are things standing right now with this vote?
Well, right now, Kate, officially in just the last few moments, Republicans have the votes that they need to get this budget passed and to move towards tax reform. We saw Speaker of the House Paul Ryan on the floor moments ago casting his vote for this budget, something that a speaker typically doesn't do, underscoring how important this vote is and frankly, how narrow of a victory that they had. Republicans could only afford to lose 22 votes. They were close to that number. But of course, they got over the magic number 215 that they needed to pass this budget through. So what happens next? Well, they still have certainly considerable issues still to be ironed out as they move towards now putting pen to paper and writing this tax reform bill. A lot of concerns from the New Jersey, New York delegations who, as you saw on the floor moments ago, voted against this budget. Concerns over the SALT issue, the state and local tax deductions issue. That was a major concern that led them to vote against this budget. That has to be solved going into next week. Then the Republican committees writing this bill when they unveil their big tax reform vote. Also over the 401k issue, that a big issue still hanging out there. So a lot of details to be ironed out, but certainly a big partial victory for Republicans today in their march towards advancing tax reform. Kate?
Yeah, I mean, and this is especially in these days on Capitol Hill, take a victory where you can get it. Republicans, I'm sure, are breathing a sigh of relief if they've just passed this one but essential hurdle. This happening just as we're coming to air right now. Sunlyn, great to see you. A lot more to come. Now, the big work when it comes to tax reform. We're all also watching breaking news on the other side of Pennsylvania Avenue we want to tell you about. President Trump is set to declare the opioid crisis in the country a public health emergency, with more than 140 Americans dying of opioid overdose every day. The president has long promised action. Is he making good on that today? Let me bring in right now CNN chief medical correspondent Dr. Sanjay Gupta for much more on this. This announcement is going to be coming a little later this afternoon. Sanjay, you have followed and documented this crisis extensively. What does this declaration mean today?
Well, you know, we're going to find out. I think there's going to be some details, hopefully, as to what this means, because I think there's a lot of question marks right now. First of all, it's a public health emergency, we're hearing, not a national emergency. You may remember that was the term used earlier. These are two different things. A national emergency typically has money attached to it, usually lasts about a year. A public health emergency doesn't have any federal money attached to it. It's basically telling the agencies, this is really important, pay attention to it, and do it for at least 90 days. So different lengths of time, different money. That's what we know, but how it translates, I think, Kate, we're gonna wait and see.
Well, that and that's the big question. And you point out it seems in the weeds, but it is an important distinction between a public health emergency that's being announced today, a national health emergency, and that seems to be what the president has previewed in the past few weeks. It's not as broad as what we're likely to see today. There's not additional funding immediately attached to it.
Right.
So in your view, does this fall short of what the country needs?
Well, I think that there's, you know, specific solutions that have been long discussed by many within the public health community, you know, being able to get additional resources for counseling, for rehabilitation, even for things like medically assisted therapy for people who are addicts, as you point out. I mean, there are more people dying unintentionally this way than any other cause in the United States. It's remarkable. So, you know, if you're serious about it and there are solutions out there, we know those solutions cost money. We know they can be implemented. Is it going to be enough to actually get those solutions going, you know, more so with the force that it needs? I don't know. It's tough to say. You would think that would require extra money.
Yeah, but recognition on the presidential level is important.
Yes.
No matter what, to talk
no
about
question.
Putting a highlight on the crisis. You've done so much work on this, and we talk about it a lot, but lay out from your view how bad the crisis is right now. Where is it?
Yeah, and let me just point out, you make a good point. I think, you know, even now there are people who still look at this issue and are going to hear today and say, wait a second, this opioid crisis is that big?
Right.
You know, even though we've been talking about it for years, I think it's still really coming into a lot of people's spheres just now. So it's the number one cause, accidental overdoses from drugs, number one cause of unintentional death in America today. More so than car accidents, and opioids are the biggest part of that. So just think about that. All the advances we make in medicine and health, this sort of erases a lot of those things, this American man-made problem. We consume 90% of certain opioid classes in the United States. We are 5% of the world's population. We consume 90% of some of the opioid classes. So you get an idea of the problem, the demand, and the consequences.
90%. That is an astounding number. And it's really just the beginning of it. Every data point that you see with this crisis is more and more astounding that you see. Great to see you, Sanjay. Let's see what the president lays out today. Thank you so much.
Got it.
Let's discuss this and much more. Joining me right now, CNN political director David Chalian, Eliana Johnson, national political reporter for Politico, and CNN senior political analyst Mark Preston. Great to see you guys. Let's get to just all the kind of breaking news that just happened in the past couple minutes. But let's start with where we were with Sanjay. Mark, this is a moment that the president has kind of teed up for a month or so now, something that he talked about on the campaign trail with the opioid crisis, something that folks have been waiting to see on what he would deliver with how he has previewed this. Is he delivering today?
Well, it remains to be seen. You know, as Sanjay said, this is a very complicated issue that we're dealing with right now. But as we talk about partisanship here in Washington, it seems to be an issue that everybody can rally around, whether they're Republicans and Democrats. This isn't a partisan issue. This is really, as Sanjay said, a health care crisis. And in many ways, even though it's not going to be called a national crisis, it is a national crisis. You know, we all are affected by this. We all know somebody who has been affected by this. It is so pervasive at this point. And when people look to Washington, they're looking to Washington to help them with issues like this. We'll see now if when President Trump unveils everything and what he plans to do, will Congress work in concert with him to really try to overcome this real terrible epidemic.
And David, this is a crisis that hits the whole country, but it also hits very hard parts of the country and parts of the electorate that supported very much Donald Trump.
It does, without a doubt, and you noted it does hit the entire country. It's just one of those horrific, epidemics that just go. I don't know, a family, a neighborhood, a community not touched by this. And you are right. Donald Trump encountered this time and again on the campaign trail. He talked about it all the time when he was in New Hampshire. His voters at rallies, he noted, were experiencing this. So you are right that it hits the communities that supported him, as it does every community. And that gets to Mark's point about now will be the test to see, well, if that is the reality, can something like that bust through the partisan logjam that exists? And and you heard today also going into this event with the president, Kate, the big question that hangs out there is sort of, this is the message and this is the photo op. I don't say that pejoratively. This is the, you know, the president using the bully pulpit today.
Yeah.
What comes next after that is, do you back that message up with money and medicine?
Yeah. Eliana, let's talk taxes. How important was this step that happened just now in the House of Representatives in getting this budget approved?
This step is important, but it is merely a means to the tax reform bill that is supposed to be unveiled on November 1st. And I think the proof is in the pudding with that. And we're already seeing some obstacles. House Ways and Means Committee Chairman Kevin Brady yesterday really struggling with whether he can lower the amount that Americans put away in their 401k. It's $18,000 now. Is he going to lower it? He's butting heads with the president on that and some other issues. So this was an important step, but it is merely a step. The pot full of gold at the end of the rainbow is that tax reform bill, which is supposed to be unveiled November 1st.
And David, I mean, with this outcome, now fast-tracking how Republicans can get any tax bill through, do all the concerns of the state and local taxes, the 401ks, do they all go away? Did members of Congress just lose all their leverage?
I think those concerns only get amped up now, Kate. I don't think they go away at all. I think now, as the actual details get revealed next week, the state and local taxes, 401k, whether or not there's an additional bracket in the millionaire category, these are going to be the hot button issues that get very, very hotly debated in Congress. So I think all those concerns, look at the list of 20 Republicans who voted against this budget today. They're not going away, and their votes are still going to want to be wooed. Republican leaders are going to want to see if they can bring them on board. So it's exactly the issues that you outlined, that if you look at that list, you see where the leadership in the White House has their work to do.
Yeah, and speaking about the White House on this, yes, the White House laid out priorities, Mark, but has the president laid out what he's for and what he's against? Because when it came to health care, kind of where this ended up, was Mitch McConnell saying, tell us what you'll sign and we'll get to it. Has the president laid that out yet?
Yes and yes, but when I say that, by doing so, he's only created more confusion, right? He said that 401ks would not be touched.